it's wonderful. And what could be more peaceful and relaxing than gliding down Michigan's shimmering AuSable River on a pleasant summer afternoon? The famous AuSable Valley, cool, green, quiet, delightfully tranquil. Right up until the first weekend in October. But when autumn comes to the AuSable, look out! It's time for another Northcountry Classic. Series, in football the Rose Bowl, hockey has its Stanley Cup playoffs, and in the exciting and strenuous world of distance canoe racing, it's the AuSable River Valley Canoe Classic that stands up as the toughest test a man can master, or try to master. That's the way it's been for years, as hundreds of U.S. and Canadian teams have pitted their stamina and skill against the cold, clear currents of one of America's most celebrated streams. The race begins in Grayling, in the north-central part of Michigan's lower peninsula, and runs down through the colorful AuSable Valley all the way to mighty Lake Huron. And colorful the valley truly is, particularly when Jack Frost annually demonstrates that no man is his equal in the gentle art of creating sheer wonderworks of scarlet and rust, of yellow, orange, and tan. The combination of superb fall colors and an alone-in-its-class sporting event forms a powerful lure for sightseers. But the AuSable Valley is spacious and facilities for visitors are excellent. So outdoor lovers come in large numbers. Some of them even rent canoes from the well-equipped canoe liveries along the AuSable and try the fine art of paddling for themselves. Fun it is too, but not quite of the same order of difficulty as racing against both time and two or three dozen other well-trained canoeing teams. Each one furiously intent upon reaching the next bend ahead of you. The race is run over a two-day period. The first lap starts Saturday morning and ends that afternoon near Mayo. After an overnight break, the classic resumes at dawn. The second lap includes six portages. First comes Mayo Dam. Then portages around five other Consumers Power Company hydroelectric plants, Alcona, Loud, Five Channels, Cook, and Foote. The Consumers Hydro plants are almost as much a part of Northern Michigan's history as the AuSable. They were predecessors of the big steam electric plants the company now operates to serve its electric customers in 61 counties in the Lower Peninsula. But in autumn, the dams do double duty, providing rapidly produced electric power during times when use of electricity reaches a peak, and adding a true obstacle course flavor to an exciting, demanding race. But let's go back to the beginning and see what happens on a typical AuSable race weekend. It all starts on Friday afternoon at Lake Margreth, just west of Grayling. This is where the pole position races are run to determine the order of starting in the main event the next day. Now they're ready, and there's the start of the pole position contest. All canoes used in the race must meet the specific requirements of the judges, and most of the craft used are built by the racers themselves. The teams must follow the shoreline completely around the lake today, keeping between marker buoys and the shore in order to complete the required distance of 10 miles. The first five teams back qualify for cash prizes at an early starting time tomorrow. While the teams battle it out, visitors and guests of honor enjoy fresh air and the beauty that is abundant throughout the AuSable's backyard. Here's a form of beauty no photographer could ever resist. And what would a championship race be without a queen or a group of queens? Here come the racers now, churning hard for the finish line and the honor of starting first tomorrow. Near the lead are Urban Peterson of Coon Rapids, Minnesota, and Ron Homan of Oscoda, Michigan, one of the favorite teams this year. Homan was a member of the winning duo last year, and Buzz Peterson and his partner of a year ago finished third. Now Now they're near the finish line with Jerry Lowers of Tower City and Stan Hall of Oscoda in the running, as well as another Michigan team, Jack and Bruce Kent of Atlanta. And it's Lowers and Hall who take first place in the preliminaries, and thereby serve notice that they will be the first off and one of the top units to beat in the long run coming up. Homan and Peterson will start second tomorrow, followed by the Kents, Carl Ketter of Minneapolis, and his partner Al Whiting of Holly, Michigan, and the team of Ed Adams of Holly and Cecil Lane of Flint. It's Saturday morning and the crowd is ready for action. The racers inspect their gear once more, and the officials make a final check on arrangements. All along the river, timers and checkers will be at work to assure that all rules are followed, that all performances are properly timed and recorded. And at bridge after bridge downstream and from other vantage points, fans will be lined up to cheer their favorites on. Now they're ready. There goes the first team. It will take 13 minutes to start all 26 teams entered in this year's race. Among the crowd, the excitement is building and friendly bets are being made. Will it be Lowers and Hall, who were second in the big race last year and who took first in the pole position competition yesterday? Or Homan and Peterson, experienced hands at forging to the front in the AuSable? Or 17-year-old Ken Kolenich and his dad Steve from East Towers, who put up such a fine fight in taking fourth place the year before? Or maybe the two well-conditioned strangers who signed up quietly this year, giving their address as Wirt Smith Air Force Base, Oscoda, Michigan? No one knows yet, but from the looks of the start, it's going to be a humdinger of a race before it's finished. Let's get downstream with the crowd now and see who's first at the next bridge. This is the way the true AuSable race fan watches the contest each year. From the starting line in Grayling, he makes a series of leapfrog jumps that always put him up ahead of the leaders, or his favorite, until the fans and the teams reach the finish together at Oscoda. From one bridge or one dam, one high bluff to another, make as many stops or as few as you please. Either way, it's an invigorating, zestful way to spend a day or two after the last promises of summer have faded and before the first threats of winter arrive. It will take the racers about 6 hours to reach Sportsman's Park in Mayo, the finish point for the first day of the race. Along the way, each team has some very important helpers ready, friends who deliver sugar water and other forms of nourishment to the contestants as they pass. Though most of the racers weren't carrying any excess weight when the race began, some will lose as much as 15 pounds before it's over. Ladies and businessmen, please note, as a form of dieting, this is doing it the hard way, unless you also want to develop shoulders like a champion breaststroker and the wind of a top-notch miler. In Mayo, as the end of the first day nears, the crowd gathers to see who will hit the beach in the lead. Though the official winners of the race are established on the basis of actual elapsed time between start and finish, the relative position of each team is a matter of pride, not to speak of the admiration and applause of the fans who line the river's banks. The first teams are arriving now, and it looks as if Ron Homan and Buzz Peterson are leading the pack, with Stan Hall and Jerry Lowers, Carl Ketter and Al Whiting not far behind. Looks like no one has run off with the race at this point. Here comes the leader. It's the team of Peterson and Homan. The others are coming up behind. And though a number of entries are strung out upstream, we have a sizable representation that'll be in contention tomorrow. In second place at this point are Hall and Lowers, and in third, Ketter and Whiting. The first two teams are only 5 minutes apart, and a total of 26 minutes separates the first five teams as the first day ends. Visitors on hand to view the AuSable race find much to do and see while keeping up with the excitement on the river. If the scenery itself isn't enough, one can always meander downstream to where the colorful paddle wheel excursion boat, the AuSable River Queen, offers 2-hour round trips between Five Channels Dam and Cook Dam. The River Queen can carry 120 persons through some of the most beautiful riverland in America, with all the comforts of modern refreshment facilities and the happy music of an original Mississippi River steamboat whistle. Not far from the boat landing at Five Channels, the Lumberman's Monument offers an opportunity for an interesting pause. Thousands of vacation travelers stop here to pay a brief tribute to the men who carved out one of the early phases in the economic development of Michigan. Another unique feature of the AuSable Valley draws its full share of visitors in warmer months, too. Kirtland's warbler, which nests only in the jack pine woods of Michigan's north central lower peninsula and winters somewhere in the Bahama Islands, is a favorite subject among bird lovers. Its summer habitat, centering along the AuSable near Mayo, is visited frequently by specialists in search of new knowledge about this interesting little fellow, and by garden variety bird watchers too. Only about 1,000 Kirtland's warblers are estimated to exist. By mid-autumn, the Kirtland's warbler is in his winter home, and the action lies across the river from here, where the final lap of this year's AuSable Canoe Classic will soon be starting. This is Sportsman's Park in Mayo. It's 6:30 a.m. now, and the last act in this year's canoe race is about to begin. Sportsman's Park is a tract of land leased for $1 a year by Consumers Power Company to the Mayo Sportsman's Club, which maintains it for public use and enjoyment. It's an example of the productive cooperation between neighbors that has always been found up and down the AuSable. The teams go out of Mayo in reverse order from their arrival yesterday afternoon. And while the lapse time remains the only determining factor in winning the race, watch those lead teams from yesterday scramble to get back up front. Most of the teams are underway now, and soon the fun will start at the dam across the pond. From this point, the canoe teams have 6 tough portages and something approaching 9 hours of hard paddling, climbing, running, and more paddling between them and glory in the annals of the AuSable Classic. Here comes the first test of the day. It looks like more of the tight competition that we saw yesterday. Ron Homan, who with his partner Irvin Peterson finished first in the run down to Mayo yesterday, started last this morning. But the two of them are already back near the lead. From here on in, you might say that young Homan has at least a psychological advantage on the rest of the boys. Ron's dad has been one of Consumers Power Company's hydroelectric plant operators on the AuSable River for more than 20 years. But even if your dad runs the dam, there's still only one way to get past it. And now the final drive to the finish is in full swing. Though the results that'll be noted in Oscoda this afternoon are still in considerable doubt, at least among the racing teams, if not among their hot-eyed fans. At 5 channels, with the stately River Queen safely out of the path of this horde of Michigan mosquito boats, the mad dash continues. The river falls 600 feet from its headwaters near Grayling to its entry into Lake Couronne at Oscoda AuSable. Some of the racers will feel as if they had fallen every foot of the way themselves by the time the day is done. The end is not far away now. Ahead lies Foot Dam, the last barricade between the canoe teams and clear water to Oscoda. There, the teams must take their canoes out of the water at a designated point and carry them in one final portage to Township Hall, where the official finish line has been established and the winners will be crowned. The last dam has been passed now, and one by one the teams bear down, making every precious ounce of strength count during the hour and a quarter or so of high-speed paddling that remains. The competition this year is typical. After 13 and a half hours on the river, it's still a real race, and the lead teams can't loaf for a moment on the home stretch. In Oscoda, at the point where the canoes must be raised from the water for the portage to the finish line, the mood is one of excitement and expectation. Now the teams are starting to arrive. At the point where they leave the river, Homan and Peterson are still in front. And there they go, on their way to Township Hall and the finish line. Not far behind them are Hall and Lowers, and then Ketter and Whiting. Up ahead, the judges await the winners with prizes and commendations. Homan and Peterson reach the finish line. They're this year's winners in the official lapse time of 15 hours, 9 minutes, and 4 seconds. They are first to finish today, just as they were first yesterday at Mayo. Watch out for that television cameraman, boys. If he gets hit by your canoe, he may never get the chance to telecast your victory across the state. Less than 11 minutes behind and in second place are Hall and Lowers. The third place winners are Ketter and Whiting. After more than 15 grueling hours on the river, only 35 minutes separate the first four teams. And now to that moment to be relished for years to come. The words of the officials, the trophies, and the prize money. The AuSable race features a total of more than $3,000 in prizes, with the first place winners sharing $1,200, the second team getting $600, and the third team $300. There are also seven other cash prizes. Presenting the prize money to the first place winners is Louis Vaupre, Bay City Division Manager for Consumers Power Company. Mr. Vaupre says, "It is certainly a pleasure to see the continued high level of interest in the AuSable Classic. More people than ever are coming up during our fall color days to take advantage of the opportunity to see the foliage and the race. I know this trend will continue because the race is really an exciting event, and we at Consumers are pleased to be a part of it. May I wish the winners the best of luck. And may I say to all the people who helped with this year's race that we're delighted to share in the fine neighborliness and cooperation that have always marked our relationships along the AuSable." Six cooperating agencies participate in making the AuSable River Race possible. These organizations are Oscoda AuSable Townships, Mayo Chamber of Commerce, Crawford County Chamber of Commerce, East Michigan Tourist Association, Oscoda AuSable Chamber of Commerce, and Consumers Power Company. Technical assistance and cooperation is provided by the Michigan Canoe Racing Association. Well, that's autumn on the AuSable. A little bit of everything, you might say. All of it enjoyable, all of it relaxing, all of it... But why talk about it? There'll be another AuSable race. Tell your neighbor to keep an eye on your house while you're away. Unless he wants to join you. Then come and take a look for yourself at a true North Country Classic. Thank you.